There's this coaster in Hershey Park, Pennsylvania called the Super Duper Looper. On it, you come around this bend that's full of trees blocking your view. And before you know it, you're hurtling down the track 45 miles per hour towards a thrilling 75-foot loop. According to Hershey's website, it's the first ever looping roller coaster on the East Coast. But the good people at the Hershey Company have that wrong. Because about 75 years before the Super Duper Looper, Coney Island, in my hometown of New York, was home to the first two looping roller coasters in America. Unlike the Super Duper Looper, which has been around for almost 50 years, these early looping roller coasters didn't even last a decade. Because it turns out, loops shouldn't be made like this. Looping roller coasters got their start in Europe as early as 1842. Back then, they were called centrifugal railways. They weren't super popular or successful.
They tried a few more in Europe, and we understand that these were short-lived and more a novelty.
That's Randy Geisler, former president and current member of the Historical Committee for American Coaster Enthusiasts.
I've loved roller coasters my entire life. The movements, the speed, just the world whipping by you in every direction.
People in the 1800s didn't have the same fondness for looping coasters. And that didn't change much when America built its first looping roller coaster in 1895, Coney Island's Flip-Flap Railway. That's because these coasters had a few major problems. The biggest one being, they made the loops circular.
In physics, we love perfect circles. It's an easy shape, but from a human experience point of view, it is a nightmare.
That's Matt Anderson.
I'm a physics professor at San Diego State University.
To make it all the way around the flip-flap circular loop, cars needed to move really, really fast while changing directions.
The coaster itself is trying to push you up into a new direction. Your head, your spine, everything else wants to keep going in a straight line, but the coaster is saying, no, you got to curve into this arc.
Changing direction so rapidly causes a spike in G-forces.
You've gone from 1G instantly to 12 or 14 Gs. That's a big problem.
6 Gs is really the most a human body can handle on a roller coaster, and only for about a second. At that force,
literally all the blood is just being pulled out of your head, and so you will pass out.
You can see how wild the G-forces are in this looping coaster simulation chart created by George Sidebotham, a mechanical engineering professor at the Cooper Union. Because of our chat, he became so obsessed with the circular loop problem that he made a bunch of looping coaster simulation charts. This line represents a circular loop, like the flip-flaps. After jumping from 1 to 14 Gs, it would decrease as you reach the top of the loop, then ramp all the way back up to 14 at the bottom, and then back to 1 as the coaster leaves the curve. Passengers were completely rattled. The flip-flap, being made mostly of wood, didn't help either.
Wood is stretchy and compressy. You can see the circle moving, you know, as the cart goes around, you know, stressing it this way and then it's stressing it that way. It just looked like an engineering catastrophe about to happen.
The next looping coaster built on Coney Island, the Loop-the-Loop, was crafted to avoid all those issues. It was made entirely out of steel, which offered more stability, and the circle was switched to more of an upside-down teardrop shape. Squeezing the sides in helped ease the transition into and out of the curvature, reducing the G-forces and creating a smoother, less body-damaging ride.
But still, they had the capacity problem.
Neither the flip-flap nor the loop-the-loop could support more than a few riders at a time, because the loops were small, and so the cars had to be small too.
Most of the cars, they seated 4 people, and pretty much you could only send people about once every 5 minutes. They just couldn't make enough money. There were more people that would watch and ride.
The flip-flap lasted 7 years. The loop-de-loop lasted 9. And all other looping coasters around the world shut down shortly after. It seemed like the end of the track for loops. That is, until something new came along. In 1959, Disney unveiled the Matterhorn. It didn't have a loop, but it was the very first tubular steel coaster. Unlike regular steel, which was solid throughout, tubular steel was hollow in the middle, making it lighter weight and easier to bend into smooth arcs and curves. Unlike wood, tubular steel could support heavy weight and more dynamic movement. And in 1976, Six Flags Magic Mountain debuted the first modern vertical looping coaster made with tubular steel. The Great American Revolution squeezed the loop even more than the loop-de-loop, creating what's known as a clothoid loop.
It gets smaller and smaller and smaller as you get to the top to try and even out the G-forces, and then it does exact opposite as it comes back down.
With clothoid loop-shaped coasters, designers could distribute the Gs more evenly and decide more precisely how many Gs to hit. About 4.9 in the case of the Great American Revolution. A much smoother experience compared to the flip-flop's uneven G-force spikes from 1 to 14 to 9 to 1. This clothoid loop, crafted using strong and easy-to-bend tubular steel and built 113 feet high, meant that the Great American Revolution could support 20 riders at G-forces that feel exhilarating instead of harmful. And since then, loops have exploded in popularity. Double loops, crazy loops, and that super-duper looper in Hershey Park, which, by the way, can proudly claim that it's the first modern looping roller coaster on the East Coast.